Hi, my name is Antonis and I'm the iconographer of this video. Today I will paint the Holy Face of Virgin Mary. It's the type of Virgin Mary lamenting for her son Jesus Christ, and it's a very beautiful type of icon, as all her sorrow for her son's death is depicted on her face. So already you see me having painted the proplasmos of Virgin Mary, and for this proplasmo I've used colors like yellow ochre and black, a little bit of white, and a little bit of iron oxide red. Now I'm painting the grapsimata on her face, and for this grapsimata I'm using some of the color of proplasmo, and a little bit of black, and a little bit of red, iron oxide red. This icon was commissioned to me by a professor of the Byzantine history from the United States, and I would really like to thank her for trusting me and supporting me as an iconographer by commissioning this beautiful icon for her. So I do hope that you are healthy, you are creative, and you stay much in your studio. This is a wonderful period of the year to be more in the studio. And let's watch together how you can paint, build a beautiful face in the style of the Cretan tradition of iconography. Of course, I'm using egg tempera here, and of course you might listen the dog of my neighbor barking. It's a wonderful big dog. Anyway, so here you see me painting these grapsimata, the facial characteristics, and if you are a beginner in this trip of iconography, I just want you to, when you are about to paint these grapsimata, just make sure that these are not too dark, too much darker than the color of the proplasmos. These should be, it's better if they are lighter than darker. There shouldn't be much of a contrast between proplasmo and these grapsimata. And of course, when you paint these grapsimata, it's always nice to pay some attention to the expression of the figure that you are painting. And now it's the time to think of this expression and try to understand what kind of features you should paint. Here, of course, Virgin Mary is sad, and I will try to give this melancholic expression of sorrow by painting the eyebrows upwards, as you see here, and painting the iris of the eyes just slightly apart from each other. They're not completely parallel to each other, and this will give a very insightful melancholic expression on her face. When we paint the grapsimata, it's time to pay special attention, to not be in a hurry. These are extremely important for the icon, and try really to give the appropriate attention these need. When you paint the facial characteristics, also try to do some blending between these grapsimata and the proplasmo, the base color. Just try to blend, as you see here me doing, the the areas where it accepts the darkness, the shadows, and with this linear way of blending and a more thin color, try to do some very basic blending. Don't just paint the facial characteristics and leave them like that. Do a little bit of blending. This information and more like this you can find on my online course.
Hi, I'm Antonis, and I'm proud to present you my online course in iconography, Paint an Icon with Me. This course will help you become a better iconographer, and it will help you be more confident when talking and presenting your artwork. It will make you understand in depth the studio practices of a professional iconographer like me, and you will get accustomed to what great iconography looks like. So learn in a simple and organized way everything you need about the materials, mediums, and techniques in order to make a beautiful icon. Paint with me the icon of Christ, and learn how to paint better any icon you wish. I will see you at the studio.
This is my online course where you can find 25 videos. It's like around 9 hours of me teaching you how to paint an icon in the Byzantine tradition, in the Cretan tradition. And you will find everything I know almost about iconography in this organized and detailed course. So here I'm still doing this blending of the facial characteristics, and of course you don't have to blend everything, just a little bit where you believe that the face could be a little bit darker. The expression on the face of a saint or the figure we are painting, it's I think, in my opinion, the most important thing. We should definitely pay much attention to how we will paint this an appropriate expression, a beautiful expression. So have this in mind. Don't just paint these facial characteristics automatically, just try to feel a little bit what's going on, and maybe also try to say a little prayer to the saint that you are depicting. Just a little bit, try to think of the feelings, the life, and get into the spirit of the figure that you are painting. Somehow this really informs the painting and really gets us into this spirit of of the teachings of the figure we are painting. Here Virgin Mary is sad, and at the same time her expression should be a little bit contained. It shouldn't be very dramatic or something like that. She is sad, but at the same time you can tell that there is the hope of resurrection on her expression. After I painted these grapsimata, the first layer of grapsimata and some shadowing, as you saw, I did paint also a darker layer of grapsimata, and I also painted like that the pupils in her eyes, and some the lower parts of the eyebrows, and some areas that need to be underlined by a darker grapsimo. For this darker grapsimo, I just added a little bit of black on my first more brownish grapsimo. And now you see me painting the first layer of light, the first light as we call it. And for this first light, I'm using yellow ochre, some titanium white, and a little bit of either carmine red or cadmium red, something to just make it a little bit pinkish. So this first light should be a color that is not too thin or too thick, just of middle consistency. I would say it's preferable to be on the thinner area rather than thicker. And with this, just try to set the shapes of light as they appear on your reference. Here again, you have to take your time and you have to be very patient, as it is very important to first understand what you see on your reference. And of course, what you see, it's a finished icon, but you have to get there step by step. So you have to, let's say, imagine what each layer of your reference might look like, and paint the same thing on your icon. Here, for example, that I'm painting the first light, I have to imagine what the first light on my reference might be. What is the limits of each shape that on my reference, and transfer these shapes on my icon. If you have some experience, this will be much easier, because you will know what to expect next for your next layer, and how much to expand these lights, how much to reduce these lights, for example. And this will really, experience should really help you. So don't be discouraged if you are a new iconographer. You are expected to do mistakes, and it's a learning process that takes a lot of time. Now, at this point, I have to announce you that I'm glad to announce you that I'm planning to do some online courses live from this autumn. From this September, I plan to organize some groups of small groups of up to 5 people, where I will teach some courses according to everybody's needs. These courses will be for beginner iconographers, where I will teach them the basics of drawing. This will be the first course. So this course will be, as I said, for up to 5 people, and it's going to be for 6 sessions. And it's offered in both English and Greek. We will meet 5 students and me on the platform of Zoom, and for 6 sessions, each an hour and a half approximately, I will teach you the basics of drawing, from the basic facial characteristics in iconography, to how to paint the head, the whole figure, and a scene, maybe a more complex scene. My second course will be a course again for beginner iconographers, I would say, but this course will be more into the color, how we paint a simple torso in iconography, a head with its torso, how we gild, how we paint clothes, face, etc. And my third course will be for more advanced iconographers, where we will paint a complex subject, a more complex scene, where we will learn not only how to paint clothes and how to gild, but also more complex elements in iconography. More details you will find here, also in the description of this video. If you are interested, I plan to begin these courses from this coming September, and you can find me on my email address if you are interested, so that I can arrange these groups according to your specific needs, your time zone, and your language. These courses will be offered in both in English or Greek according to your language. So this is some exciting news for me, and it's for many of us it's an opportunity to get to know each other. And although I think my course in iconography on Teachable, as you see it below in the description, is great. It's like 9 hours of teaching, and you have your it's very comfortable because you can watch the videos again and again. It's really helpful for many of you who have already bought the course, as you communicate me. My online course in Zoom will be something different. It's our chance to get to know each other, and it's easy to see you work live, some exercises, answer questions, and be more a course that is more interactive than my online course. Of course, on my online course on Teachable, you can find me, and I'm always glad to answer questions there as well. Unfortunately, I don't have the chance to see your faces and to getting to know you in person. So here, back to this video though. These are exciting news for me, and I'm glad to share those with you. So here, back in the video, I'm still setting these shapes of light on both the face of Virgin Mary and her hand here. And little by little, as you see, the head of Virgin Mary takes its expression, its volume, and becomes more complete. As you see, already by painting this first light, the icon seems much advanced. It only needs a little bit of blending, some more lighting, and that's it. In order to achieve this result by the first light, it's important to have the right consistency of colors, and to having done a nice preparation for with your Proplasmo and your Grapsimata. If you do some nice blendings with your Grapsimata, then and then if you also set these shapes of light with the tip of your brush, then you have done much of the work done. Now you see me doing the first blending tone. I prepare on my palette a color that is in between the first light and the Proplasmo. And with this middle tone, you will see me doing some very basic blending in a linear way with the tip of my Kolinsky brush. In my previous video, if you go back on the list of my videos on my channel, you will find a video on how to blend egg tempera with two ways. Traditionally, in Byzantine iconography, in the Cretan tradition, we use a linear way to blend colors, but there is also a more let's say quick, more vivid way, more spontaneous way to blend, and you will find all these details on my previous video here on my YouTube channel. Here you see me blending the first light and the plasmo using the tip of my brush, working with a color that is in between these two colors, and its consistency is thin enough to cover some of both areas and both colors, and create this first blending transition. And of course, I'll do the same thing with the hand. When I'm doing hands, things are complicated, and I have to observe very carefully my reference and see what's going on there. So after having done a very basic first blending, as you see now, I'm using a color that is even darker, as dark as the proplasmo, even a little darker maybe. And with this, I add a lot of egg tempera solution to make it very thin. And with just a few brush strokes, as you see, I will blend the previous first blending color with my proplasmo. This way I will achieve a very fine, very perfect blending. Where you will not be able to see a very clear transition between the proplasmo and my lights. Just make sure when you paint with this second blending color that is very close to proplasmo, just make sure that you paint on the outer parts of your photismata, and try to not cover much of your previous blending. And now you see me painting my third blending color. This blending color is closer to the light, closer to my first photisma, but not the first photisma itself. It's in between a color that is in between the first photisma and the proplasmo, but closer to my first photisma. And with this color, I will do a further blending. Of course, again, with the tip of my brush in a color that is thin enough and very delicate, very fine, with very fine brush strokes. Make sure now when you do this third blending tone that you will not go all the way towards the edge of your lights. Just work towards the center of these light shapes. Just use your criterion and try to see how and where to place this third blending tone. Try to make these brush strokes as thin and as fine as possible. And try to see how to use what is the orientation of these brush strokes as seen in your reference. Little by little, you will be able to build this the volume of the flesh, and it will become very, very nice. Here on the hands, things get, as I said, a little complicated, but the more experienced you are, the better it is. Try to make sure that the knuckles are evident. You don't lose any of the anatomy of the hand there. Although there is the stylization of the Byzantine language here, everything obeys the Byzantine language in iconography, but still there is the reference of the human anatomy. What we paint is not irrelevant to the human body, although it's not a naturalistic depiction of the human body. So you will see that you know, the first part of the finger, the part that is closer to the palm, is bigger than the second knuckle, and that second knuckle is also bigger than the third knuckle where the nail is. So these are some principles of painting a hand. And now, with these three blendings, after these three blendings are done, and after you've done some little cross-examination to see if they look great, I'm ready to re-establish the first photisma. And again, I will take some of the first photisma color on my palette again, and with this linear blending way, I will go over my shapes with the tip of my brush, with a color that is thin, and I will do this repainting of the first light. When I am mixing my colors on my palette, I always add some egg solution right next to my colors, some drops of egg solution in my colors, next to my colors. And this way, if I need something more runny, a color that is more runny, more thin in consistency, it's easy for me to take with my brush a few drops of this clear egg tempera solution, add it with my color, and do very fine blendings, very fine transitions with it. Here you see me using this. I'm using both thicker and thinner colors to re-establish this first light. When I'm about to do a blending, I will use, when I'm on the borders, let's say, on the area where the transition is happening, I'm using more thin colors. And the more I go towards the center of the lighter part of these shapes, I will use thicker color. When I'm saying thicker, don't imagine any impasto, let's say, like oil painting. Just a little bit thicker than than my runny color. So anyway, I do hope you are still with me, that you understand this process, and it's familiar to you little by little. I know many people follow these tutorials, and they do find it's easy for them with by watching these videos, and this is really gives me big pleasure, especially when people send me their the photographs of their work, and even either when it is from my online course or from these videos on YouTube. It's always very, I'm very proud for you guys, for being such great workers. You work very hard, and it's an honor that you trust me as your instructor in iconography. So I want to thank you so much, and I'm very proud for your progress, and I'm also very grateful for our little community here. Thank you so much. Now here you see me after painting the first light and doing its blending. It's the time to place some of the warmer colors on her, on the cheeks of a saint, and this is some glazing I do, very thin color. For this thin color I'm using maybe some cadmium yellow and cadmium red. It's an orangey color, or a carmine red. It doesn't really matter. You should use an orangey, I would say red, but very thin down and with very fine lines, barely touching the cheeks, the painting. You should do these warmer areas. And now what you see me doing now, it's painting this second light. And in the Cretan tradition, this second light is been worked as psimithia. Psimithia are these lines of light we see in many icons, and these are very hard to accomplish, but very charming. And I think you shouldn't avoid this way of lighting. Little by little you will master it. I'm still struggling to master it. It's not that I'm perfect. And also depends on the shape and the size of the icon we paint. The bigger it is, the easier I would say it is to paint these psimithias, because they require a very precise use of the brush and some precision. So I do paint these lines according to my reference, and I know that I'm not a robot. I know that I am an iconographer, but always in the spirit of becoming better and learning and practicing. For me, when I paint an icon, it's not it's always an opportunity to practice more and become better as an iconographer. So even if psimithias are not perfect, that's fine. The important is to try to make them better, to try to be in the spirit of this learning process, and little by little I think we will master this process. So what I'm doing here is just painting a first layer of psimithias, of lines of light, as seen in my reference. Try to observe very well your reference. And now I will do just a very slight blending on these psimithias with a very thin color. Now, unfortunately, this part of the video seems to be a little bit out of focus, but you will still get the idea. Now I'm doing an even lighter layer of psimithias. It's almost titanium white, and I will reinforce, let's say, underline, highlight a little bit more the first layer of psimithias that I painted a little earlier. One of the challenges that we as iconographers have, and this is for me as well, is when we have to restrain ourselves from being in a hurry and from getting to finishing what we paint. This is not because we are bored or we are tired or whatever. In my case, and I think in many of your cases, we are in a hurry because we just want to see the icon finished, and we are enthusiastic about what we paint, and that's why we get into a hurry just to finish the icon as soon as we can, just to see the icon finished. I think we can resist this urge. Anyway, at some point the icon will be finished and we will enjoy the final creation of our hands. But we do have to resist working very quickly and not giving the appropriate attention to the icon we paint. So here you see me painting these stronger ψημιθιές on the head of Virgin Mary, and do not hesitate to rotate the icon if you feel that that the orientation of the lines you have to paint are easier to be painted with a different orientation. Here to me it was much easier if I rotated the icon 90 degrees counter clockwise, and it was much easier for me to work the ψημιθιές on her cheek this way. Of course, if we work on a wall, on a fresco, this is impossible to happen, but whenever we have the chance, why not, and do the same thing. Now, after you paint these ψημιθιές, feel free to also do some blending again with very thin color. Just go on top of them with a color that is in between this color of ψημιθιές and the previous one, and thin it down with a lot of egg-tempera solution, and just do some more blending. This is something that I can't really teach you better. I just give you the information, but it's you and your criterion, your observations of your reference that will make you blend and paint the icon as best as you can. So back to the normal orientation. Now I'm doing again these ψημιθιές, and I want to paint now them with pure titanium white. It's time to do a third highlight of these ψημιθιές just by using titanium white that is a little bit thicker in consistency, but make sure to not overdo it here. If you have done a great preparation, as you see here in this icon with the ψημιθιές, you don't really need to do a great highlight, a pure titanium white highlight that covers everything. Just a few discrete brush strokes on the areas of the face that accepts the light most, and you are done. See how little, how discreetly I painted this third pure white ψημιθιά. Just a little bit. Again, if you want, after this pure white, you can again do some blending, but if you have done your prior work as it should, then this final pure white ψημιθιά does not really need any blending. I would like to thank also at this point my amazing supporters on patreon.com. I often upload exclusive content there, and it's really wonderful of you, my patrons, who find it in your heart to support me financially and making it possible for these videos on YouTube to be published. It's much easier for me to find some time when I have this support on Patreon. So again, thank you so much. I'm so glad you find the page helpful, and if you feel like you can always find me on patreon.com and support me there as well. So here now I will paint the lips of Virgin Mary, and I will use some cadmium red with a little bit of iron oxide red for the upper lip. I can also lighter even further if I want with some more orangey color. Do not be afraid to make the mouth as pink or as orangey as you see it on your reference. So here I paint the lower lip with a more pinkish and brighter color than the upper lip. I used to be afraid to use garish colors, so brilliant pinks and reds for the lips of the mouth of a saint. But now, and after observation of older icons, I find it more easy for me to just paint them as red as they should be. And for the eyes here, I will paint now the lighted part of the eyes by first painting a layer of gray-bluish shape right next to the iris, and then lighting this blue-grayish with by adding some cadmium, some titanium white, and making a second layer right next to the iris, as you see now. And at the end, I will make a third one with just pure titanium white. And of course, when we paint these lights, the icon just magically comes to life. It's, I think, in my opinion, a dramatic change when these lights appear right next to the iris. So it's really beautiful. And also you paint the eyebrows a little bit as you see them in your reference. So little by little this face comes to an end. Now you see me painting the pupils in the eyes of Virgin Mary, and as I've said, I can paint pupils all day long. It's really satisfying and beautiful. If I want, I can further do an underlying of the grapsimata. This is something that is not... it's up to you, in my opinion. Some iconographers omit this part. If you decide to do this darker grapsimo, be careful to not overdo it. Do not cover anything from your previous layers. Just very slightly, very discreetly do this highlight. Anyway, this is the painted part of Virgin Mary. Thank you so much. It was a pleasure to be in touch with you today, and I will see you soon with another video tutorial. Be healthy and be creative, and stay more in your studio. Thank you so much. I will see you soon. Bye.